Neil Peterson, and with me today is Ranier Crick. He's the Managing Director of Sentinel Homes. So welcome again to you, Ranier. It's great having you on the show again.
Thanks, Neil. Nice to see you.
So today we want to gain some valuable insights, obviously in the 2024 property market landscape, to see where it's placed. And particularly, we're going to focus on today on the recent repo rate cut and the South African Reserve Bank, MPC, the Monetary Policy Committee, has obviously cut it by 0.25%. We're hoping if this is enough, and is this going to bring the much needed relief in our economy? So this is the discussion that we're going to have today with Ranier. So Ranier, maybe just starting off with that key question, is a 25 basis point cut enough to stimulate the struggling property market? And it is a struggling property market for the last couple of years.
Yeah, I think at least for the past 18 to 24 months, it has been a bit of a struggling market, as you say, Neil. I personally think that it is enough to kickstart a bit of a revival in the market. It would probably have been better if it were a larger cut, and I think that the arguments for a larger cut are incontrovertible. But this may be hackneyed by this point, but the fact of the matter is that pent-up demand is a feature of the property market in South Africa. So people buy and sell property when they have changes in life circumstances. And many of those changes in life circumstances happen no matter whether we're in a high stage or a low stage of the interest rate market. It's only that when we're in a high interest rate environment, many of those changes in life cycle don't manifest themselves as trading in property. And that's why then, volumes are reduced in the market. The problem is that then obviously the drive for those changes in life circumstances to manifest as property remains relevant and is actually just waiting in the background for the rate cycle to change. So many consumers have, in anticipation of this rate cut, which was a foregone conclusion almost before the meeting even started of the MPC, have started coming into the market. So the anecdotal feedback that we have from bond originators and estate agents is that suddenly the lines that they have in the water are getting bites. People are approaching bond originators for pre-qualification, et cetera. And so many people realized in the sort of build up to the decision that it was time now to get, sort of their feathers shaken into form. And then I think after the announcement, it's only been about a week now, we're going to see some increase in market activity. It's also because the weather is turning, South Africans tend to buy property at higher rates when the sun is shining and the weather is fair. So those two things coupled, the fact that there is this pent-up demand in the background and many people could see the rate announcement coming but waited for it to manifest itself because people want for it to be tangible, right? They want to put their fingers in the holes, if we can use a biblical analogy. I think it will be enough to start sort of the thing going. And I mean, the governor has also said that, the model shows that there will be another 25 basis point reduction in November. And the market has heavily priced in that reduction in the interest rate again in November already. I don't mean the property market now, I mean the money market and the bond market. I think it's enough to kickstart it, if I can answer your question. Do I believe it was enough? Do I believe that the arguments for keeping it at 25 rather than making it 50 are good reasons? I don't.
Well, let's have a look at the US market, which is quite surprising. The Feds actually reduced their interest rate by 0.5%. And normally, South Africa tends to look over their shoulder and they kind of watch what's happening in overseas markets. And we saw in the UK, they also had a rate reduction. But I think quite surprising in the US was a 0.5%. And I thought on the back of that, they probably would have looked at a 0.5. And existing homeowners, we're still seeing that there's still distress in the market. So maybe isn't that just another reason maybe that they should have considered that 0.5%?
Yeah, so I watched the announcement. I watched the full half an hour of Governor Ganyahu delivering his address and statement, and then also answering the questions. And the interesting thing about our governor and the august group that we have in panel there at the MPC is that they're exceptionally hawkish, right? And so I think that there is a basic paradigmatic difference between the people who are, say, running the Fed and announcing rates, and the people who are running the SARB And their hawkishness has stood us in good stead a few times in the past, right? And they've also shown that they've shown through the COVID crisis that they have the strength, the courage of their convictions to cut rates dramatically when there is a crisis situation or whatever, right? But when it's sort of plain sailing and business as usual, they tend to do the very cautious thing. And if you read the statement again, as I did this morning in preparation for my talk with you, then what is very clear is that they're saying we're going to cut it again in November if the model allows for it. But we don't really know what's happening. There is a lot of uncertainty for us in the world, which, once again, I would argue is not a novelty. There is always a lot of uncertainty in the world. But there is a lot of uncertainty for us in the world. Does the model allow for a 50 basis points cut? Yes, probably. Do we think it's better doing it in two increments? Yes, we do. And that's just conservatism, hawkishness coming to the fore. In the Fed, I think there is much more of a cowboy mentality, and they saw the opportunity for a 50 basis point cut, and they absolutely grabbed it with both hands, considering that, you know, they're also thinking about other things like the possibility of a recession in the United States, and also the fact that, you know, that they worried about jobs, and there's this constant talk about, you know, whether the economy will have a soft landing after this very high recession, inflationary environment. And they seem to think that, you know, reducing quite strenuously or quite significantly is the way of balancing all of the various risks that they have. It's also important to note that a 50 basis points cut in America, where the rate is now, the target federal funds rate is now in a range between 4.75 and 5%, is a much larger percentage than, as say, a 25 or 50 basis point cut off a policy rate of 8.75, which is what the repo was before the announcement. So even if we were to cut 50% for 50 basis points at the September announcement, that would not be the same in magnitude really as a 50 basis points cut in America. And the governor was at pains once again to say that we're not followers. We don't follow America, but if you plot on a graph the American interest rates and their movements together with the South African interest rates and their movements, then it's very clear for the last 10 to 15 years, we have been following, I mean, that line, those two lines sort of follow each other almost exactly, with our interest rate announcement sort of always just slightly trailing behind the American announcement, because we know that, you know, much of our trade is dollar-based. And those dollar-based, because we're an importer of inflation, amongst other things, those dollar-based things do make a difference. And so we need to look at what America is doing, whether we want or not. And once again, the governor in his announcement put a lot of information there about what America was doing. When we bring it to the home loans industry or to the residential property market, the fact of the matter is that they don't really care about it. They look at asset prices loosely. And there are some property related things in the inflation basket. So it is part of what, you know, is being used. But the governor is, every time that a question is asked of him, whether you've considered this thing or whether you've considered that thing, he makes it very clear that they view their inflation targeting mandate as their prime thing, and they don't really look at anything else. They don't worry about, they look at growth, but they don't worry about it. They only look at it as far as it impacts their inflation forecast. And the same with probably asset prices and everything else that they may consider. And so whether there is distress in the property market and whether there is default in the property market, whether prices are growing or decreasing, that's not really something that they're worried about, because it's not in the inflation metric, which is the only thing they view as their priority to target.
Okay, so let's just look a little bit about the historical sort of averages, because I think it was around about 2001, if I recall, when interest rates started a downward trajectory and probably ignited probably one of the biggest property booms that we'd seen in South Africa in the history, I think, from 2002 to 2006, where we saw exceptional growth of capital growth of property, and obviously banks opened up the boss, they said, right, here we are, we're giving you the loans, and it went on an upward trajectory. How does it compare? Because and coupled to that, you know, with local analysts, you know, I mean, I just want to just go, are they still too conservative in their forecast? If you look at Goldman Sachs, they're quite optimistic, and so double-handed, just historical versus the sort of conservativeness, as you say, hawkishness of the local. Your thoughts around that?
Yeah, so I think that is part of what the hawks will argue, right? Which is that, yes, we can see that the real interest rate, that is the repo minus the inflation, is high because that is a measure, right, of what we're doing in the economy. The SARB views that 2.7% real interest rate is sort of a neutral position. So they're quite above that at the moment. You know, 8.5% minus the 4.5% of inflation is a real interest rate of 4%. That's significantly above the 2.7% neutral position that they've touted in the past. And so what we're essentially saying is that as an economy, we're favoring those with assets above those who don't have assets. Because if we reduce the interest rates, if we reduce the real interest rate, then the economy will have some stimulus. But now, as we saw in 2001 to 2006, when the interest rates are low, sometimes that doesn't manifest really as growth. All it manifests as is asset price inflation, which really isn't also isn't to the direct advantage of poorer consumers. And so the reason we would want to keep inflation low is because once again the impact on poorer consumers is much more than on the impact on richer consumers, and that's why we have inflation targeting, right? We don't want the economy to become too hot. We want for it to grow at a measured pace and have inflation of a measured proportion within the target band set by the Reserve Bank. So I think that that. When we compare it, that would be the argument. The argument would be we want for it to be measured so that where the economy has the opportunity to grow, we want for that to be not in a hot fashion where we have unrealistic asset price inflation without really bringing the benefits into other things like job growth and the kinds of things that mature growth in the economy will produce. And so I think that's the, I would think that that is the hawkish argument. Whether it's correct, I don't know. I don't think so. I think that at this point in South Africa, we need to start doing some things that require a bit of conviction because the unemployment rate has been very stubborn, and we must face the fact that we can inflation target until the cows come home. If we don't have an economy because we have some sort of violent unrest or whatever, then that's going to be much more detrimental to our future prospects. And the fact of the matter is, I think, Neil, that at the moment the climate is such that it's a last ditch attempt. This government of national unity is sort of on the tail end of the population's gedult, what is that in English?
Patience.
Patience, there we
No,
are. Sometimes
that's
the English teeth take a bit of time to warm up.
fine. All good.
I think that population generally, if we were to take the temperature, is at the end of their tether as far as patience is concerned. And so we need to do something drastic in South Africa to get the economy buzzing and working for everyone. And I think the argument is strong to say that to the extent that a high real interest rate favors those with assets, in other words, the haves, at the expense of the have-nots, it's not really morally justifiable. And the economic argument can be made in the direction of the larger cut, which I would therefore say, if it meets the moral and the economic standard, then I would say why not? It seems that the august group in the MPC don't entirely see eye to eye with me on that.
Okay, great. So let's talk a little bit about the recent national elections and the government of national unity. Has that influenced market confidence and economic policies? And you know, we've just seen recently the Minister of Public Works and Infrastructure, Dean McPherson, saying in July, and it was endorsed by President Cyril Ramaphosa, he's saying, let's turn South Africa into a construction site. And that's all linked to, for me, into the property market, to property development and everything else that goes along with that. Which is all sounds very bullish, but so maybe just your comments around that.
Sounds great, eh? The fact
Okay.
is, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to drive around South Africa and see that as far as housing is concerned, I mean, there are other infrastructure challenges like the electricity grid that you know is falling behind and can't we can have all of these electricity generation products, but we have nowhere to put them into the network, and then we have the crumbling roads infrastructure, we have the problems with Transnet, with the ports and the rail infrastructure. I mean, there's a lot of infrastructure thing that Minister McPherson hopefully is thinking about when he's saying, let's make South Africa a construction site. And also, when you think about what the labor is that we have available in South Africa, then large-scale construction programs, whether they're public or private or public-private partnerships or whatever, probably meets the demand that we have for job creation. And so from that point of view, fantastic. There are all sorts of corruption challenges here and also crime things like the construction mafias and those kinds of things, which everyone is making a lot of noise about treating in the correct way, which everything of that is fantastic. The problem in South Africa is that, as far as the residential market is concerned, most of that development happens, when we look at rand value, in the private sector and not in the public sector, right? Because building houses is not something that the government really does, unless you look at RDP houses, but they're a small value relative to the balance of the market. And so the question is, where is the gap for actual expansion in the residential market? And the answer is that the easiest thing is there's a large unmet demand for housing in the middle of the income distribution. That is the gap housing market. Now, this is everyone who is too rich to qualify for an RDP house, and using rich there seems facetious, but it is what we're talking about. So household incomes about 3,500 rand, you don't qualify for an RDP house. And then depending on your definitions, household incomes up to, say, 26,000 rand per month. This is the so-called gap housing market. People who are too rich for an RDP house and too, say, poor to go into the general market, obtain a mortgage in the normal fashion, right? And those mortgages in that market make up about 10% of mortgages granted when you're counting by account. And actually, it's a third of consumers. So it should make up about 50% of mortgages granted, right? So there's a big shortfall there. There are a lot of consumers who are not being served. And the question is, why is that? Because the government has this first home finance subsidy, also FLIST. And so the demand is definitely there. There's some assistance from government, the FHF subsidy, which is largely not taken up, right? Millions and millions of rands of free money go back to the fiscus every year because they're not taken up. So the question is, why is this demand for housing not being met by the private sector actors who have capital and who are in the business of meeting consumer demand? And I have a simple answer for that question, and that is, it's a very simple one. When you engage in a property-related transaction with a low-income consumer, it's costly, firstly, to engage in that transaction, and secondly, it's expensive and exceptionally costly to get out of that transaction if something were to go wrong. Whether it's an eviction or a foreclosure against property in South Africa, both of these things have a high social stigma due to historical reasons and also due to the press reporting on this in a very peculiar fashion. And secondly, are very, very, very difficult to obtain. We need the reverse. And I argue by analogy, if you look at World War II, the countries in Northern Europe after World War II had been bombed, right? And the thing about Northern Europe is if you don't have a house during winter, you're dead. So it was very important, even though the infrastructure was flattened, to get everyone housed as soon as possible. So what did those countries in Northern Europe do? They relaxed consumer protections in the market, and they made it so that it was easy for the holders of capital to invest money in the market. And then, once everyone was housed, they stealthily reintroduced those protections. And that's a natural process because the consumer is also the electorate, right? So things that favor them tend to be borne out in the laws as time goes by. The problem we have in South Africa is that we have a regulatory system that mirrors, say, the Netherlands at the moment, but we don't have housing at the same level as the Netherlands. In South Africa, there is a large proportion of people who, even though they are in the middle of the income distribution, are compelled to live in a shack because there is simply no place for them to buy a house. And even if they could get the house, they couldn't get the loan to go with it. But this is a politically a very difficult thing to do, because obviously there's a lot of emotion involved. But the system that we have at the moment seems to say implicitly that once you've lived in a brick and mortar house, you've somehow become special. And we will protect you, even if that is to the detriment of people who haven't yet had the opportunity to live in a brick and mortar house. Argued by analogy again from another point of view. People taking the risk of starting a new business is more likely in jurisdictions where bankruptcy laws are easy. Because if the cost of bankruptcy is low, people are likely to venture the chance. And this is precisely the same argument obtains here. If the cost of exiting the transaction once the consumer is not paid is low, then people wouldn't mind taking a chance. And what will happen in that kind of system is people might be might be given a chance and fail, and be given a chance and fail a couple of times through their lives. But it beats the current system because they will at least be granted agency over their own lives and they will be given a chance. And if you give enough people enough chances, many of them will stick in the market. And that is precisely what we need if we want to marshal private capital to get into this. And there's more than enough money available in the market and in the world. It's just a question of making the return and the incentive acceptable for the private market actor that is deploying that capital. That is the problem that we have in South Africa, Neil. If you want to make it a construction site, unfortunately, that falls outside of Mr. McPherson's portfolio because it's not a public works question. Government is not going to be able to marshal enough capital, public sector capital, in order to build the houses that we need. It'll have to come from the private market, and it's also the quickest way of getting it. But to do that, you're going to have to clear obstacles that the political will may not exist to clear those obstacles in the current environment.
But he could be trying to initiate sort of private PPPs, public-private partnerships, and I think that's really what the call was to try and initiate that and to get that off the ground, because that is definitely not happening enough. Because government themselves won't be able to do that themselves. So just linked to that, I mean, so what are the measures that can be taken to support first-time home buyers who are currently struggling?
Well, it's very easy. You must not support them. That's what I'm saying. You mustn't support them. There's this the saying. It was one of the Stoic philosophers. It says we must treat the body rigorously so that it does not disobey the mind. And by analogy here, I would argue that we must treat defaulters rigorously. In other words, deny them unnecessary accommodation in the law and in practice. Because by granting the people who are defaulting too much leniency, we are in fact disadvantaging everyone who's standing in line waiting to be granted an opportunity. And so I have the greatest sympathy. Losing a house is terrible. But this is the sort of real estate version of the trolley problem, right? Which is you have the opportunity to benefit a few or a small amount. Which do you choose? And it's always a difficult question. And unfortunately, given that we all have to wear the big boy pants every day, life is messy, and unfortunately, sometimes people do get the blunt end of the stick. And that this is what is necessary in our real estate market in South Africa. It's simply unacceptable that people don't pay rent and then can't be evicted, and it has to take so long. It should be very simple and very easy. If you don't pay, off you go. Cheers, because it sounds facetious to say, but there's always the option of living in an informal settlement. And we're saying that it's good enough for a large amount of people in South Africa. And by having the laws and the systems that we have at the moment that are too accommodating to those who don't pay, we're essentially saying, though not directly, that those people must stay in the informal settlement because they'll never be granted an opportunity to access formal housing. And so if we want to solve the problem, which is all of the people in the line, I would say more than people who are defaulting being treated poorly, the line problem is the more important one, and we should solve for that and not for the one of people who are defaulting.
No, I think it's a big contentious point. It was actually brought up at the recent SAPOA conference where they discussed the PIE Act, of course, which said is very exactly what you're saying there. So they're concurring with you that it's, it doesn't serve the investor and, in fact, the anybody who's looking to buy. So let's talk a little bit about, there was a little bit of a spat between you and Housing Minister. Then it was on a recent article that was published, I think, in The Citizen. And Mameluke Kubayi, she's our housing minister, and maybe you can just share a little bit, how this whole thing. I know she made a comment about these discriminatory practices when it comes to granting loans, and I think there was a retort and a back and forth between the two of you. Maybe just give us a little bit of background to that,
So I stepped on the minister's toes or her
René.
department's toes, it seems, because they reacted rather vehemently and accused me of being unable to work Google and basing my conclusions on alternative facts and an ahistorical view of how the economy works, all of which are interesting allegations. I understand. Yes, it's easy to step on someone's toes without meaning it. My passion personally is getting South Africans out. And sometimes when you're passionate about something, you may step on someone's toes, which I mea culpa, I seem to have been guilty of that. But I was making precisely the same argument which I'm making now, which is that the real thing that is necessary, which is solving for the queue rather than solving for the incumbents, requires political will. It requires doing something that is politically difficult. In South Africa, if you're the Minister of Human Settlements, race baiting is politically easy because there are a lot of people who want to believe you. The press generally takes the bait hook, line, and sinker, and then everyone reacts hysterically. And there are a lot of people who find that the race baiting accords with their experience in the world, and there you have the problem. Now, unfortunately, we rely on leaders to be leadership. And so the minister was reporting there on statistics that were reported to a department inside of the Department of Human Settlements, the Office for Home Loan Statistics, and it was constituted under the Home Loan and Mortgage Disclosure Act. But the minister gave a certain set of conclusions, which is that it seems as though there is racial discrimination and the contents of that HLMDA Act must be increased. You know, it must be given more teeth. But the statistics that the minister was giving at her press release don't match the conclusion that she was presenting, which is obviously a bit of a problem. And then if you delve deeper into it, you may find that although home loan outcomes correlate with race in South Africa, that is as a result of how the country looks and not as a result of race being an actual consideration. In fact, in every home loan application, race is collected. We have to collect the statistics, but it's only because the law compels us to collect it. If we weren't compelled to collect it, it wouldn't have been a relevant variable and it wouldn't have been collected, because the fact of the matter is that whether you get a home loan or not is basically two considerations, which is what is your past performance when it comes to the payment of your credit exposures, and what is your current affordability level? And that is the end of the inquiry. Whether it is a black or a brown or a white hand, paying the money is irrelevant because banks are profit-driven institutions. The other thing is that the minister is alleging that there is discrimination against the racial majority in South Africa, which is different than, say, discrimination against the racial minority, as you may see in the USA, which is a counterexample that was presented to the argument that I was making. It's a totally different kettle of fish. In South Africa, it is simply ridiculous to believe that there is some racially dogmatic, regressive cabal sitting in the back room of a bank, making decisions in secret, and decisions that are, despite being secret, also inimical to the profit incentive of the banks, who are all profit-driven enterprises. So it's silly, and it's race baiting, and it's not supported by the statistics reported on by the minister. And I think when our leaders are silly, we must take them to task for it. And that's what I did, and perhaps a little bit vehemently. I accused it, amongst other things, of being asleep at the wheel. But what I mean by that is that it's easy to race bait. That is politically easy. And the real solutions to the problem are things that are politically difficult to do and are all around market design. Because if you design the market correctly, business will supply in the demand. There's that anecdote about some Russian economists who visited the UK in the heavy years of the Cold War during the 70s. And one of the economists on the Russian side, over a cup of tea or perhaps a bit of whiskey, asked one of the London economists, "Tell me, who is the official who is responsible for the bread supply in London?" Because in the communist mindset, there won't be bread unless someone manages it so that there is bread. And of course, no one manages the bread supply in London or anywhere else where there's a capitalist economy. People eat bread and want it, and the shop shelves just fill with it. So if there is a demand for a certain kind of property in South Africa, property in a certain price class between, say, 300 and 900,000 rand, and there is not enough supply, that means there is a market design problem, and the market design problem should be solved. And the market design problem requires difficult solutions, things that are politically challenging. And it seems as though there's no real desire or even grasp of the solutions amongst the public sector officials who are tasked with being the leaders and getting this thing done. Which is regrettable, because who is getting the short end of the stick? Poorer consumers, which is exactly what we don't want. We want people to be in the market. We want the economy to grow. Imagine if we took this housing backlog of, let's say, 2 million units, and we supplied 10% of that per annum for the next 10 years. Can you imagine all of the laborers that will need to be trained in things that are specialized, like, say, plumbers and electricians, and will be able to provide for their families as a result of that boom? Can you imagine all of the of the voters who will be granted the dignity of living in a formal dwelling and having a stake in the economy and being involved and having the chance at least to move out of an informal settlement. I mean, there's a lot of moral and political and economic good to be done in getting the solution for this problem. But unfortunately, if we're stuck on race baiting and race baiting and race baiting, we're never going to get there.
You were also at the conference at BizNews with me at the beginning and in March, and it was Christo Visso, you know, billionaire investor who's a contributor to the Kyle Lamb Project for Free Market Foundation. They've already, I think, handed out 16,000 titles at something like 5,000 Rand a pop. So people that cannot afford land or living in a structure and have now been awarded the land, and now it's worth something like 100,000. Do you think that, I mean, government is sitting with a mass amount of land. There's a lot of people, I think it's 10 million people in South Africa that are living on structures like that. And you mentioned the shacks and that kind of thing. And, you know, for me, that it looks like it could be a low-hanging fruit if government could just realize that potential. Your thoughts around that?
Absolutely. Why is the government sitting on tons and tons of land if it could be productively used by transferring it to the people who are living there already? You know, say the land on which an informal settlement is established. If the land is sterilized, government is never going to be able to clear, say, what is that informal settlement next to Steyn City? I forget now. But if we look at Diepkloof,
if we look at Diepkloof,
never going to be clear. So can we just transfer the title of the land to the beneficiaries who are living there at the moment, and that's the end of the matter? But it's not only government that's at fault here. Well, government is at fault, but it's not only government that's a culprit. There's another big one, and this is one that I'm also going to potentially come under fire for being culturally insensitive, but there is no reason why the Zulu king needs to control so much land in South Africa. There are people who are living in land in traditional areas under the Ingonia. Guardianship of the Ingonyama Trust, where there's really no reason except keeping the Zulu king relevant for not transferring that land to the beneficiaries. People are living there for generations. They can't sell the land. They can't meaningfully improve it because they can't obtain loans. They can't sell it. And so if you don't live there anymore, it's given to someone else. I mean, it's an old school, outdated manner of owning the land. It entrenches sort of a bygone era of traditional land rights, which I think is disadvantaging the people who are living there. And they might not agree with me, and this may be culturally insensitive, but the fact of the matter is that we live in a market economy, and if we agree on those principles, then we should grant these people the access to these assets. There's no use keeping it away. If we can get as many people to have a stake in the economy as possible, fantastic. And that unfortunately is not happening with entities like the Ingonyama Trust, and then also with government ineptitude, you know, not knowing what land we have and who is on it and whether it's being put to productive use and whether we can perhaps transfer title of those parcels of land to indigent people who are occupying it already.
Interesting, you mentioned Diepkloof, and in Diepkloof, 16,000 people are employed by Steyn City, which is the big high-end development right next door to Diepkloof. So you mentioned about handing over titles. For me, it makes a lot of sense. And these people are ably actually employed next door. And so some good ideas. But just in final, René, can you maybe give us your crystal ball? Give us your, where do you see this interest rate cycle playing out? I mean, you've mentioned, the next sitting is in November. You know, how do you see, let's look a year ahead. How do you see everything sort of playing out within the next year in terms of specifically the interest rate cycle and the implications thereof?
So I'd be willing to bet my left hand, and I'm left-handed, that the rate is going to come down by another bit at the November meeting, probably 25 pips. Although the MPC has been very non-committal about it, we can understand that they can't promise a program of cuts or a program of increases. They have to have the meeting decide and then give us the result, right? That is what they must do. So we can understand why they can't promise it to us, but they've given strong indication also that, you know, in the near term, they actually expect inflation to dip below the center of the target band. So they're targeting between 3% and 6%, but they want expectations to be anchored at 4.5%, which is midway between those two extremes. And they see that the inflation is actually going to go below 4.5%. So if we look at what the bond traders and forward for their forward rate agreements are saying, I think that interest rates are likely to go to the sort of 2019 level, right? Repo rates at around, say, 7%, which implies that, there's about a 1.5% of cuts left. So 25% at the next meeting, that leaves 125 basis points or 1.25% still to be cut before we reach sort of the bottom of this interest rate cycle. And so if you were to press me for an answer, I would be a betting man on the November meeting. And then I'd be cautiously optimistic about the remaining 125 basis points that I expect in the sort of 25, 26 years to happen through as the cycle goes its course.
And will this kickstart the economy? That's the key, because is this going to make the banks open up their purses and start to giving loans? Do you think that's going to be a result there?
Unfortunately, the interest rate alone is we're putting too much pressure on the interest rate as a variable, I think, if we expect that. The interest rate is an important part of cooking the soup that we need in the economy, but it's definitely not the only or even the most important ingredient. It's sort of garlic. The onions and potatoes and meat and beans in the stew are other things like structural reforms and creating the correct environment from a sort of an atmosphere point of view, getting sentiment right from a business point of view, getting foreign investment in,
Getting
delivering
jobs.
on sort of getting jobs going by doing what Mr. McPherson wants to do in his portfolio, but also making sure that in the other areas, like say transport, where we have significant failings, and also in the area of electricity, we must be proactive and get these things done. Clear the obstacles to growth that are very clear there. That we must clear the drain that the SOEs are on our economy, and we must get rid of the people who are draining the fiscus with corruption and mismanagement. And all of these things are even more important, I would say, than the interest rate. And so if we don't realize the full growth potential of South Africa, I don't think we can lay that at the door of the governor or his MPC. We can say, listen, chaps, you were a little hawkish, perhaps. And I'm saying chaps, but I know that there are some ladies on that group as well. But we can say, you as a very august and very responsible group, you were a little hawkish. I think, but the real magic is going to be in whether the government has the political will to deliver these other structural reforms, and whether the sentiment that drives us in the direction of those things continue beyond the tenure of President Ramaphosa, which unfortunately remains to be seen.
Renee Crick, Managing Director, Sentinel Homes. Wonderful chatting to you.